Okay, it's recording.
All right, so would somebody please sit near the camera and aim it more or less in the right direction? So, welcome to Physics 466. This course is supposed to give you the basic background in mathematics used in virtually all of physics. There's a second course, 467, which I think is also worth taking, but it's got some things that are important for experimentalists, like probability statistics, and some things that are more important to theorists, like path integrals. On the other hand, path integrals are intrinsically interesting, and there's also group theory. Effectively general relativity in the second semester of 467, but it's not hardcore general relativity, it's simply the mathematics of general relativity, whereas one can make general relativity arbitrarily difficult, not doing that in 467. Let's see, the class webpage is come on in, pick a seat anywhere. It's quantum.phys.unm.edu/466-17. And you don't need to really write that down. You can just go to the physics department website and you click on classes and class home page. Click on 466 and it takes you there. You might wonder, what am I doing with a laser? Well, there's a demo involving polarization that's related to vectors and also related to quantum mechanics, and I want to do that for you at some point in today's lecture. I haven't really decided about grading. The policy I'd like to follow, if there were no chairman, no administration, no colleagues, I'd just give everybody A's and get back. Unfortunately, my colleagues, some of them are bigger than I am, and in fact, most of them are bigger than I am, and so I've got to do something about grading, and I'm just not sure what. And if any of you have any good ideas about grading, see me in the hall or come by the office. My office is 176. It's basically, you go out that door, keep going more or less straight, and through the double doors, and I'm on the left. I tend to be there every afternoon, even on the weekends, sometimes in the evening, but mainly late afternoon, but I'm rarely there in the morning. I just have trouble getting up in the morning. Okay, so let me just tell you one thing about the textbook. It's what you want to get is the one that is printed or reprinted in 2014 with corrections. Some publishers are responsible, like Cambridge, Oxford, and some others, and they put out, in second printings, they'll fix typos and so forth. Other publishers are irresponsible, like Elsevier, Wiley, and so forth, and they don't fix typos. I'm going to put a lot of emphasis on homework. In fact, I can tell you that homework will be a large part of the grade. The attitude of this department in general about homework is that One way to do the homework is just to do it by yourself, and that's fine. If you have enough background and you can do it by yourself, that's the best thing to do. Another possibility is to think about the problems, get started on the problems, and then meet with a group of friends and work out the rest of the problems. Those are the two possibilities. Doing problems is very important because problems require examples, and the human mind is simply designed to generalize immediately from examples. And in fact, we do that automatically. But if we don't see the examples, then the generalizations are just kind of floating there, and not so good. Okay, so let me now start going through the material. The first chapter of the book is on linear algebra, and you might say, well, we all know linear algebra. And I hope that's true, but on the other hand, there are some things about linear algebra that most physicists, especially most students, don't know, and that are important. And secondly, it's that linear algebra, you see, is used a great deal in quantum mechanics, because the vector space of states is a linear vector space. So I guess that's the main reason why I like to start with linear algebra and emphasize it, because of its importance in quantum mechanics. A second feature of linear algebra is that it's basically totally solved. And so there are computer programs that can do basically everything almost by the time the return key gets back up, if you push it down, the thing is done. And so it's a very effective field of mathematics. Okay, so you know the, I don't know, should I use this? First of all, does anybody have a vision problem? Okay. Do you like that, or would you rather see something like this? Is that, that's easier to see, probably, huh?
Yeah. Okay.
All right, so those are the natural numbers. R are real numbers. C, the complex numbers. Natural numbers are zero and the positive integers. Rational numbers are ratios of integers. Irrational numbers are things like this. X equals a sum of d sub n over 10 to the n, where n goes from some n0 out to infinity. So this is what a rational number looks like. And so 1 half, of course, is obviously rational. 1 third, 0.333. These are repeating decimals. Those are rational. Pi, of course, is irrational. And the real numbers are basically all the numbers, including the, so basically the, I could say the natural numbers are inside the reals, are contained in the complex numbers. And the real numbers are kind of spooky. There are all these numbers that are in between the rational numbers, and it's a puzzling sort of thing in a sense. Okay, complex numbers are linear common. Are real numbers with one extra number, I, such that I squared is minus 1. And we often use Z for a real number, a complex number. The real part of z is then x, the imaginary part of z is y. And if you add two complex numbers, then what you get is you just add the real numbers and you add the imaginary numbers, so it just looks like that. Multiplying, I'm sure you know all this, but somehow it's okay, so what you get here is x1, x2 minus y1, y2 plus I times y1, x2 plus x2, whoops, I got that wrong, x1, y2. Okay. The polar representation of a complex number is z is r e to the I theta, say, and of course this is r cosine theta plus I sine theta. Now what's the subtlety here that's very important to recognize? It's very simple, but it can get confusing, and it shows up over and over again in complex variable theory. And it's that, whereas this represent, when you represent a complex number like this, x and y are uniquely determined by z. In particular, x is z plus the complex conjugate of z over 2. So it's x plus iy plus x minus iy, the complex conjugate of z, which is also written this way, is of course x minus iy. And if you add these two together, of course, what you get uniquely is x, and y is z minus z bar over 2y. That's uniquely y. So this representation of the complex number is unique. That is, the x and the y are uniquely given by z. On the other hand, this representation is not unique because you can say z is r e to the I theta plus 2 pi n. So in other words, theta is not only not unique, it has infinitely many equally equivalent values that are equally good at representing z. So the polar representation has this. It's very convenient because then when you multiply z1, z2, you just get r1, r2, e to the I, theta 1 plus theta 2, but you have to keep this sort of in mind. This r here, of course, is the length of z. R is what we'd say is the absolute value of z, and that's the square root of x squared plus y squared. And now you can say that theta is the arctan of y over x, but in a sense the arctan has this ambiguity built into it. Various computer languages have cope with this by having something called a tan 2. A tan 2 of y and x. I don't understand why they write y and x instead of x and y, but at any rate, this gives us a theta where theta is less than or equal to pi and greater than minus pi. So that gives us, if this is the complex plane and this is a point, then it'll give this value, the angle theta, or if the point is down here, it gives that value of the angle theta, and same thing for over here. And so in other words, it goes
from zero down to almost to minus pi, and then it goes here from zero all the way to minus pi. So that's E tan 2. That's one way of getting a unique angle from a complex number. Okay, the absolute value z squared, of course, is z times the complex conjugate. People write that as zz bar or zz star. The bar is easier because it's just one stroke, whereas the star, you've got a stroke, you've got three strokes. Kind of tiring. The inverse of a complex number, you must know all this. I'm a little embarrassed to tell it to you, but what you can do is multiply, you know, you've got x plus iy, that's the inverse, but you multiply top and bottom by x minus iy, so then you get here z bar, and this is absolute value of z squared. So that's a nice formula for the inverse of the complex number. Okay, the next topic is something that I think I'm going to tell you about just because it's interesting and it's good to hear about it while you're young. So if you hear about it later, you'll say, oh, I know that. I've seen that before. But we're not going to do much with grasping variables. I just want to tell you something about them. And actually, they're in a homework problem or two. But apart from that, it's I'm not going to be doing much with grasping variables. They only occur in the book again in the chapter on path integrals when the path integrals are path integrals of fermionic fields. So what are Grassmann variables? Grassmann variables are numbers that anti-commute with each other. So first of all, the anti-commutator of any two things is just theta I theta j plus theta j theta I. And if these are Grassmann variables, the anti-commutator of any two of them is zero. And so in particular, the anti-commutator of theta I with itself, which is just theta I squared, is zero. So the square of any Grassmann number is zero. So that means that in some sense, Grassmann arithmetic and Grassmann algebra is very simple, but inasmuch as if you interchange the order, you obviously get a minus sign, that means that Grassmann variables are just, there's just no end to the minus signs. And personally, I've always dreaded minus signs. We have to use them, of course, but too many minus signs, and then one starts to get confused. Okay, but the thing that's really simple about them is, suppose we have an arbitrary function of two Grassmann variables, of just two Grassmann variables, then the most general form of it is f0 plus f1. Yeah, I should have called these not I and j, but 1 and 2. That's what they're actually called. So f2 theta 2 plus f1 2 theta 1 theta 2. So this is the most general function of two Grassmann variables. So the space of functions is vastly simpler. This is the most general power series in two Grassmann variables. Whereas with real numbers, you'd have your most general power series, you know, an infinite series. So that's why they're simple. But in fact, as I said, these minus signs can drive one nuts. Okay, the next concept, of course, is arrays. And arrays are ordered sets of complex, of numbers, and could be any kind of number. So they're just ordered sets. And the simplest ones are, for example, A1, A2, dot, 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 AN, so this is an n-tuple of numbers. The A's could be real numbers or complex numbers or Grassmann numbers, whatever. And this ordered array of n numbers, we write it and think about it in several different ways. If it's written this way, we call it a row vector. If it's written vertically, A1, A2, down to AN, we call it a column vector. But there's no mathematical difference between a row vector and a column vector. They're the same thing. It's just that for matrix multiplication, or for dot products, it's more convenient, at least, I don't know, the way I learned linear algebra was that I always like to have the column vectors on the right and the row vectors on the left, and then I sort of dot that into that. Or if there's a matrix in between, one can, if writing them as row and column vectors facilitates certain operations, but mathematically, they're all just n-tuples. And these numbers are called the entries or the components. In linear algebra, the two most important kinds of ordered sets are the n-tuples and the two-dimensional arrays, which we can call matrices. In other words, something that has two subscripts, A, I, K. And these numbers, again, are the entries or the matrix elements or the elements of the matrix. A 2x2 array, as you know, is called a matrix. And a 1x1 array, a 1xn array, or an n-by-1 array is called a, we often call it a vector. The word vector, though, has two senses, and we want to keep in mind, we want to distinguish between these two senses. The one sense is that it's just simply an array like this, an ordered set, an n-tuple. Another sense I'll get to in maybe 5 or 10 minutes. Now, if you have two n-tuples, you can add them together. A1 dot AN plus, say, B1 dot 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 BN. The sum of those two is A1 plus B1 dot 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 AN plus BN. So that's how one adds n-tuples or vectors, row vectors, column vectors, whatever. If you have instead matrices, and then A plus B, the sum of two matrices, have the ikth element as the sum of the two ikth elements. So it's the same concept. You add components. Let me just write something, a note to myself here. We can, of course, for two matrices, we can also multiply them. And then AB by K is the sum over J of AIJ BJK. Now, of course, this only works if this thing, if A is N by L and B is L by, say, N, then this product works, because then the sum over J makes sense. That is to say, A has the same number of
columns as B has rows, then that works. Otherwise, matrix multiplication doesn't work. I'm jumping ahead when I do that. Okay, now, you can multiply arrays by numbers. So, for example, if you have an array, a three-dimensional array, AI, JK, then you can multiply it by Z. And we can say that ZI, JK is ZA, ZI, JK's element of the array ZA. Now, if you have two arrays, I was mentioning here the special kind of multiplication that we use all the time, especially in quantum mechanics, for matrices. But there's something much more general that one can do, and it's called an outer product. And we actually do use this in quantum mechanics, especially good books on quantum mechanics. Dirac invented a special notation for it that I'll go into on Thursday. But here, what we can say is suppose A is an entiple and B is an emptiple. Well, then you can take the kth element of the product. I get so many prank calls. Anyway, this is AIPK. So in other words, this is an entiple, this is an emptiple. You can make an outer product just like that. This outer product, then, is a two-dimensional array, and you can think of this as a matrix, if you want. And you can also do it a different way, though. You can say, do BA, and BAKI, well, then this would be BKAI. Well, this, then, is the same. You write it in opposite order. Obviously is the same as long as these are objects that you can use. If A and B are complex, then you can form the ikth element, and I'm talking again outer product here. And you can make various outer products. You can do B bar A I K, so that would be B bar I A K. And if A is a two-dimensional array and B J L M is a three-dimensional array, then you can form an outer product that's I K J L M. That's a five-dimensional array. Product. So these outer products are very general. As I say, we don't talk about them much in when I was an undergraduate, let me say, and in fact a graduate student, these things came in sort of through the back door in quantum mechanics classes in Dirac notation, but never saw them in an algebra class, whereas they're worth talking about. The one that we do teach a great deal is called the inner product. So the inner product, if we have two real entiples, A and B, so they're entiples, then we can write it as A dot B or as A comma B. And this is then, or let's see, A dot B, A comma B. Oh, Dirac's notation is AB like that.
And then this is A1, B1 plus A2, B2 plus dot 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 AN, BN. So that's the normal dot product that we all learned about as undergraduates. If A and B are complex, then AB or AB is now A complex conjugate dot B. And so this is the dot product of A1 bar, A2 bar, dot, 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 AN bar with B1, B2, BN. And so this is a sum, A1 bar, B1 plus AN bar, BN. So that's the inner product. And the complex conjugate of the inner product, and it's good to keep this in mind, that's AB complex conjugate. And Dirac's notation for that, by the way, is BA. And I should never depart from my notes because getting back to the notes is confusing. But anyway, let me write down all these different forms for this. B comma A, B bar dot A, I think that's most of them. Anyway, that of course is just A1, B1 bar plus dot 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 plus AN, BN bar. Or, in the case in which these things are don't commute, then you write the B's on the left-hand side. So in other words, you write it as B1 bar A1 plus okay, so suppose now by the way, you may wonder, why did I bring candy to class? I brought candy to class because I give candy to students who ask questions. And I just noticed no one's asked a question yet. Of course, I've been covering very elementary things, so I'm not surprised that there haven't been very many questions. But, well, the Grassmann variables aren't elementary, so. When I first started giving candy in class for questions, I said I was going to give these chocolates to any student who asked a question. One student raised his hand, what kind of chocolate? So I gave them the chocolate. But, of course, the candy is mainly for questions about the mathematics, not about the candy and politics. Okay, so suppose we have an M by N matrix, A, I, K, and an interval, B, K. Then, of course, we get a new interval that is A, I, 1, B, 1, plus A, I, 2, B, 2, plus dot, 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 A, I, N, B, N. And we can write this as sum k equals 1 to n aik bk. By the way, sometimes I will lapse into a notation that's very common in physics and possibly math classes nowadays, namely that I might just write AIK, BK. So often, if an index is repeated, it's often summed over. So that's called the summation convention. It was introduced by Einstein and it's gradually crept into much more general use because it saved writing this whole thing when it's obvious what this meant.
In matrix notation, this thing is just written B prime equals AB, with the understanding that, of course, A is a matrix and B is a vector. Yes?
While we're on the topic of notation, is there a reason you use a single bar R for the reals instead of a double bar?
You mean that I just wrote it R rather than double?
Yes.
Oh, that's just, I was just lazy. That's
okay. Thank you very much.
Yeah, all right, here, let me get it handy for you. Okay, well, what I mentioned earlier, I was supposed to say it to this point, if A and B are such that there are as many columns in A as rows in B, then the product can be written this way, AI1, B1, L plus A, I, N, B, and L. And that's, of course, matrix multiplication. Okay, now, there are a lot of things that we do to matrices that we want to know about. One is called the trace, and it's sometimes written this way, trace of A. Sometimes it's written this way, trace of A, and now that looks like H-bar. In fact, I missed a class when I was a graduate student. I missed the first, not the first, the second or third lecture in a quantum mechanics course. And when I came in, I saw this, and I thought it was H-bar, but it was really the trace. TR rather than H-bar. Anyway, what this is A11 plus A22 plus down to ANN. So it's the sum of the diagonal elements. And so we can write this as sum AII, I equals 1. Now, so there are some simple features of the trace. The trace of AB, of course, is this double sum of AIK, BK, let's see, what did I use here? I, of course. So the product AB would be AIK, BK, L in general, but if we're taking the trace of the product, we set L equal to I and sum over I. So we're summing over I and K. But now, you see, you can, if A and B are just real or complex numbers, you can rewrite this as BKI, AIK. But now you see, this is the trace of BA. So the trace is the order, the trace of two matrices is independent of the order. And from that it follows that if you have the trace of a product of matrices, the trace of the product is cyclic. And so let me write what that means. Trace of A, trace of ABC down to Z, say. And this is the same, you can imagine that this is one, the product of those matrices is, of course, another matrix. And so you can certainly say that this is trace of BC down to Z times A. But then you can do it again and move the B. And then you get trace of C dot 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 Z, AB, and so forth. So you can keep moving things in that direction or in the other direction. This is also the trace of Z. A, B, C, dot, 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 y, I guess it ends in y if they're in alphabetical order. So the trace is a very simple, has very nice properties, I should say. The trace from matrix has very nice properties, namely it's cyclic. And that's something that one uses in quantum mechanics all the time, and in linear algebra. Okay, the transpose. Mathematicians have a really nice notation for transpose. They just say A prime IJ is AJI. In physics, we, for some reason, we're always talking about different things, and we also use prime for derivatives, and so we tend not to use prime for transposition. But if we did, that's what it would mean, and sometimes we'll do that. Well, what we often do is we have a small capital T, or a small upside down perpendicular sign. It's, in fact, if any of you is a LaTeX ace and knows a good standard AMS math or something, LaTeX command for transpose, let me know. I just do something clumsy to generate this, because this is what we use in most physics texts, because the prime is typically A and A prime. Yeah, like over here, I use this prime, not for transpose, but just to say, to distinguish the image of B under the matrix A from B itself. Okay, so that, anyway, that is the transpose, however you write it. And the interesting thing about the transpose, well, an interesting thing about the transpose is that if it's the transpose of a product, well, what is that? The transpose of the product, it's curious, it's not an exercise, but I didn't do it. Well, what is the transpose of the product? Well, it would, first of all, when you have the product, and the product, the ijth element of the transpose of the product, well, this would be, you'd first of all do the multiplication, and you'd have AI J, say, B J K. Let's see, I was using I J, so let me switch to K here. AI, can you guys see down here? Maybe not. All right, hold on. We have AB. The I J element is AIK. BKJ. And now we have AB transpose. Let's do JI. So this would be then the transpose of that would be AB. Whoops. Yeah, AB. What am I trying to show here? Now I lost track of what I'm doing. Well, all right, let me just show you the rule. It's A, B transpose, B transpose, A transpose, and if we write out B transpose, this would be B, let us say, IK, but it, so B transpose IK
A transpose KL would be BKI A LK. But of course, if we're multiplying them, then yes, then, so this then is ALK BKI. And this is then a sum here over K. And now when we have this sum over K, to make it look like matrix multiplication, it looks like this. And so this is the AB LI matrix element. Whereas this is B transpose A transpose IL. So B transpose A transpose IL is equal to AB LI. And so that says that the transpose, that's this rule here, namely that this is then AB transpose IL. So AB transpose is B transpose A transpose. So it's all here. It's curious that I didn't either assign that as an exercise or do it in the book. Any questions? Now, does the adjoint, or as some say, the Hermitian adjoint, this is after a man called Charles Hermite, who died in 1901. Anyway, the if you have a an N by L matrix, A, then a dagger IJ is AJI complex conjugate. And so then if you take AB, and now what is this? This is A transpose complex conjugate IJ. So the Hermitian adjoint, which is written as a dagger, is the transposition and the multiplication and the complex conjugation, or the non-complex conjugation followed by transposition. And of course, complex conjugation doesn't screw up ordering, but transposition does. So this is B dagger, A dagger. Now it sometimes happens that a matrix is equal to its adjoint. And so what that means is that AIJ is AJI complex conjugate. In that case, we say the matrix is Hermitian. And in quantum mechanics, Hermitian matrices or Hermitian operators more generally are used to represent physical objects, and the reason is that their eigenvalues are real. We'll see that later. Three examples of Hermitian matrices are the Pauli matrices. I'm running out of blackboard, so I'm going to write the Pauli matrices here. Sigma 1 is 0, 1, 1, 0. Sigma 2, 0, minus I, 0. And sigma 3 is 1, 0, 0, minus 1. The Pauli matrices are great for doing rotations, for discussing the group SU2, for discussing spin 1 half objects. They're used for all these three things. And now, suppose you have a matrix that's both Hermitian and real. So then A is equal to A dagger but that's the same thing as a transpose complex conjugate, but it's real, so that's an interest A transpose. So that means that A is equal to A transpose, or Aij is equal to Aji. And we call such a matrix symmetric. And if you have a real symmetric matrix, then if you take, let's see, what did I call that? A. What would this be? Well, this would be a sum, or let us say I and J, VI complex conjugate, Aij, Bj. And what you can see then is that this is real. And the reason it's real is that if you take a complex conjugate, well, in Dirac notation, it's essentially automatic because VAV complex conjugate would be simply VAV. So it's hard to make it anything but real. But if we did, if we just took the complex conjugate of that, what we would have would be VI Aij Vj bar, because A is real, so we're talking about A real. And then this is the same as that with just I and J interchanged. So if you interchange I and J, you get Vj Aji V bar I. So now this is the same as that because the matrix A is symmetric. In other words, Aji is Aij, and so that then gives you sum Vj Aij Vi, and bar there. And now this is exactly the same as that. So a real symmetric matrix gives you a structure that such that if you have the same vector on both sides, you get something that's real. So we can say in the reals. The Kronecker delta, delta ik is 1 for I to the k, 0 for I not equal to k. And the identity matrix, of course, has matrix elements which are delta ik. The inverse of a matrix, of course, is one such that the product of the matrix times its inverse gives you the identity matrix. And here, for a matrix to have an inverse, it has to be square. So it's n by n, m by n, whatever. I've been writing matrices and vectors as lowercase. You can also write them as uppercase, and so just to emphasize that, we could switch, and in fact, my notes, I switch now and use capital letters. If a matrix U is such that U dagger U, and that's the identity, then U is unitary. And unitary matrices, naturally form groups, as do orthogonal matrices for that matter. But anyway, let's leave that aside for the moment. A matrix is orthogonal if it's unitary and real. And so then the transpose of the matrix times the matrix gives you the identity. And that also makes groups. So in fact, most of the standard groups of physics are made of orthogonal or unitary matrices. So this is orthogonal. We can say that a matrix is non-negative
What do we mean by that? What we mean is that VAV, which is sum on I and J of VI complex conjugate, AIJVJ, is greater or equal to zero. So this is a non-negative matrix. It's positive or positive definite if for any vector V, the thing is actually positive for all non-zero vectors. And positivity is a curious sort of thing. Here's an example. You can look at the matrix 1, 1, minus 1, 1. This is a matrix that's positive on the space of real vectors, real two vectors, but not on the space, but it's not positive on the space of complex two vectors. And so that's just a slightly surprising thing. How about representing imaginary and complex numbers? Well, 0 minus 1, 1, 0 is something such that if we square it, what do we get? We get minus 1, 0, 0, minus 1. So this is minus 2 by 2 identity matrix. So in a sense, this is a matrix representation of the number I, equivalent to minus I. The 2 by 2 matrix 0, 0, 1, 0, on the other hand, that just gives us 0. So that can represent a Grassmann number. And in fact, let's see, I'm running out of board space here. Let me write a couple of Grassmann numbers here. It turns out that if you're okay, if that's theta 1, this is theta 2. Okay, if you play with these two 4x4 matrices, you can see that they can represent Grassmann variables. That is to say, the anti-commutator theta I, theta j, is 0, where I and j run over 1 and 2. It turns out these can also represent the annihilation operators for two fermionic states. So we can let A1 equal to theta 1, A2 equal to theta 2, and then A1 adjoint, just theta 1 adjoint, and or transpose since they're real, A2 adjoint is theta 2 adjoint. And those then satisfy the anti-commutation relations for two fermion modes. That is to say, AI AK dagger is delta IK, and AI AK is 0, and the same thing for the adjoint. So these matrices can represent the operators that annihilate and create fermions. But this gets, see, that's what I said to you before, namely that
Grassmann numbers are very simple because the algebra is simple. The most general function of two Grassmann variables is just that simple expression there that only had four complex coefficients. On the other hand, representing them requires that if you have n Grassmann numbers or n fermionic modes, your matrices have to be 2 to the n by 2 to the n. And of course, that gets exponentially big. On the other hand, well, anyway, let me not go on in that direction. I think I ought to do the demo now, even though we're not quite at the end of the hour. Oh, we have a screen. I wonder if this screen works. What do you know? Okay, what we've got here is a laser that's polarized. It even stops. So, I haven't taught in this room in a couple of years. I should have been 5 last year. So, photons are, you know, spin one objects. And the remarkable thing about the laser is that it produces the photons such that they all have almost exactly the same momentum and the same energy. That's why the beam, you can shine it, and with a good laser, the spot comes out, it's this big, and you know, 100 feet away, it's only slightly bigger than it was when it came out of the laser. That's one reason why I was so aggravated when Bill Clinton would say, focus like a laser. It's not. When the laser comes out, beam comes out, focus, you don't need to focus. Because I voted for him, right? I'm not criticizing Bill Clinton, plus product, except for his physics. Okay, so what comes out then is a particle of spin one with precisely defined momentum and energy. But there's still an extra variable, namely the spin of the photon. The photon has spin one, and because it's massless, the spin is either in the direction of motion, like that, in other words, it's spinning like this if it's moving that way, or it's spinning like this if it's moving that way. So it's either left-handed or right-handed, or some people say that helicity is either positive or negative, or a more physical way of saying it is the angular momentum is either in the direction of motion or opposite direction of motion. The magnitude of the angular momentum is h bar. And so it's either h bar that way or h bar the other way. Now, what these polarizers do is, well, first of all, that's the most physical way of describing the photons. You can then take a linear combination of two photons that are circularly polarized, and if you take the right linear combination, you get something that's plane polarized. And so then you can have that angle of plane polarization can be, it's some angle in the plane perpendicular to the beam. And these filters select plane polarization in so they both select out a particular kind of plane polarization. Okay, so we can see some of this just directly looking at the because if you take an optics lab you will that is not good. I'll bring the screen down. The thing is an inch below it. Let's see. Can I raise this?
there we are, although it does look stupid being almost at the very bottom. I'm going to raise it some more, just because I know that some of you are in the back. And, all right, that's as high as it goes. Okay, so that's the beam. Oh, nuts. Now that I've raised it, the polarizers are too short. I don't know how high I can raise these. Well, that's tight. I should have set this up ahead of time. For one thing, we want to turn the lights down, and so this is selecting out one, and you notice if I get a particular angle here, I've pretty much blocked the beam completely. It's almost zero there, whereas if I turn it perpendicularly, it's coming through pretty strongly, but it's still less than it is. Basically, half the photons get stopped with one of these. Now, here's what's interesting, and I think I'm going to need a volunteer with steady hands. Okay. All right, what I want you to do is to hold this more or less there and then rotate it so that we get essentially zero transmission. Yeah, I know, but you can rotate it that way. Yeah, sure. Okay, okay, that's great. Okay, done. Try not to move too much. Now, here's the amazing thing. This normally stops half the photons, right? But if I stick it in between, you'll see the thing get brighter. See? It actually got brighter even though I'm stopping half the photons coming out of the laser. So I stick it in there, it gets brighter. And it doesn't matter that much what the angle is. It does matter to some extent. If I bring it in, I can bring it in such a way as to again stop them all, but if I can bring it in at just basically an arbitrary angle, it makes it brighter except for one angle. Okay, I guess that's, I think that's enough. You can put it down. Thank you. Here, you get at least one again. All right, so let me tell you now what, this is the deal here, of course, is that what we're talking about is a two-dimensional vector space in which one vector is angular momentum this way and the other vector is angular momentum that way. And you can make various vectors out of that space, so you have a two-dimensional space of vectors. Now, what happens with the polarizer is the polarizer just lets through only a one-dimensional space of vectors. It says that the vectors have to be plane polarized in the vertical direction. So that's a certain linear combination of angular momentum in the direction of motion and opposite the direction of motion. Actually, when they come out of here, they're already polarized. I hope I mentioned that to you. So they're coming out of here polarized a certain way. You held this in such a way as to hold it such that
all the ones that came out were stopped. Okay, and then I stuck another one in, and magically we got the thing to be brighter. What's going on here is that this is a quantum mechanical measurement, in effect. And so when I put this in a funny angle, what was happening is that this one at a funny angle was letting through photons that are polarized at that funny angle. Now, photons polarized at that funny angle are a linear combination of the ones polarized the way it came out here and ones polarized in the direction that he held the polarizer in. And so, I'm not describing this very well, but anyway, the point is that what I stuck in there gave us the photons coming out were a linear combination of two vectors, one of which could get through this, the way he was holding it. All right, so let's see, maybe I should have said that in mathematical terms. So we'll say that the laser sends out photons that look like that, plus, and then, what was your name?
Vahid.
Vahid?
Yeah.
Okay, so Vahid was holding these such that the only ones that could get through were minus. Okay? And so when he held the thing, we had the plus ones coming out, and then he had effectively a measurement device that selected only the ones that were in the opposite or perpendicular polarization, and so essentially nothing got through. On the other hand, if we have these ones that are coming, the photons coming out, which are plus, and then I held a polarizer or a measurement device that was in a funny direction, and so the ones that got through here, in other words, this thing that's plus is a linear combination of S, which is slanted, plus something that's, let us say, perpendicular to slanted, something like that, maybe complex coefficients. Anyway, the ones coming out are slanted plus the ones coming out of here. No, this one is slanted plus perpendicular to slanted. And so what got through was slanted. And now, these slanted ones are a linear combination, so maybe I should have written Z prime. This is, let us say, W plus W prime minus. So the ones that got through were S, but S is the linear combination of W plus W prime minus, and the pluses can't get through because he stopped them. Vahid stopped the pluses, but the minuses can get through. Okay, so what we had then was laser, plus coming out, slanted, what comes out? Slanted, but slanted is, let us say, some complex number W times plus W complex conjugate times minus, and then Vahid had his polarizer like that. That stopped plus, and what got through was W bar minus there. Well, I think I finally said it in an intelligible way. Okay, so what's interesting about this, I think, is that it illustrates It illustrates some basic properties of quantum mechanics and some surprising properties, because it really is surprising that we had this beam coming through. Waheed stopped it completely. Then I stuck in a filter that normally stops half the photons, but the spot got brighter. And this is the algebra for that. Plus goes to slanted, which is a linear combination of plus plus minus, and then minus can get through Waheed's filter, Waheed's polarizer. All right, we're at the end of the hour. I don't want to go over. So my plan is to get through chapter one in the first 3 weeks. I'm going to have to talk more rapidly somehow. There are problem sessions. So we have a problem session in room 5 tomorrow at 2 o'clock. The problem session is for your benefit, and it's a good course to take because you should be able to straighten things out. Are there any questions? I've only given out 2 pieces of candy. I went to Costco over the weekend for a whole box. Any questions? Yeah.
What was the room? This is right after 5 is in dessert game. What was the room in time for the problem session?
The room is 5, and the time is 2.
Okay.
Yes.
Do we have to sign up for them?
What?
Do we have to sign up for them, or can we just show up? Like, do we have to sign up for the problem?
You can just show up. This is a public university, so everybody is, in my view, entitled to attend any class. Free charge, mind you. The university won't give you a grade or a record unless you sign up, but I have no control of the registrar. The registrar can't even spell physics. They list all the physics courses, PHYC, which is generally crazy for 35 years. All right, well, let's turn off the camera. So.